Okay, the next item of business is a committee debate on motion 7487 in the name of Jackson Carlaw on petition PE1865, suspend a surgical mesh and fixation devices. To invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I invite Jackson Carlaw to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. Mr Jackson, for around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Colleagues across the Chamber will not be surprised to hear me speak on the subject of mesh, or that in this, the 10th anniversary year of this issue, first being raised in a public petition to this Parliament by Elaine Holmes and Olive McIntyre. However, I do so today on behalf of fresh petitioners, Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall, have brought this particular petition to the Parliament's attention, and on behalf of all those affected by the issues raised. Now, members will recognise the similarities in the issues raised in this petition and in our previous debates in this chamber on the subject of transvaginal mesh, and I hope they will appreciate and be patient with the need for plain and uncomfortable discussion of the facts. While our previous discussions focused on the experience of TVT in women's health, Rosanna and Lauren have highlighted significant additional concerns about the wider use of mesh and made clear in their petition that our attention should also be focused on the use of mesh in other surgical procedures, for example, hernia repair, and the effects that this has had, is currently having, and will continue to have in the use, if the use of mesh continues for men, women and children across Scotland. Now, in raising this issue, Rosanna and Lauren are urging us to be cautious in the use of surgical mesh until more information is gathered and we have a better understanding of the complications and adverse outcomes resulting from these procedures. In their view, this should include investigation of the concerns around potential cancer risks associated with the use of titanium staples to secure the mesh. In considering the issues raised by the petition, the committee heard from individual members of the public, including members of Sling the Mesh campaign. We've been able to explore the experience they have shared by gathering further information from the Scottish Government and also from clinical specialists familiar with the alternative options for hernia repair, and I'll say more on that shortly. The committee is also grateful to colleagues who have joined us at various points in our consideration to offer contributions on behalf of their constituents, and I see several of them in the chamber this afternoon. Look forward to hearing further from them. We also heard from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, who in the government's initial response to the petition said that he did not believe there was evidence to justify a pause in the use of relevant devices, stating mesh resulted in lower rates of recurrence, fewer serious adverse events and a similar or lower risk of chronic pain. It struck me at our first consideration of the petition back in September 21 that this was almost exactly the same testimony we had heard in relation to the previous position on transvaginal mesh. In that case, people had been dealing with their issues individually. Information on their experience and outcomes was not centrally gathered, held, or reviewed. And until people knew that there was a wider issue to speak out about, there was not much information available in the public domain. Since then, the committee's received over 85 written submissions, and the majority of these are personal testimony from individuals detailing the life-changing effects mesh complications have had for them.
Of course.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Jackson Carlaw for taking my intervention. He mentions the symmetry with the considerations of the committee around this use of mesh and the previous use of mesh around transvaginal therapies. Does he agree that there's also a symmetry there with the fact that risks were not imparted to patients in advance of them undertaking those procedures? And similarly, a stigma around their experience of pain, where sometimes they were just not believed?
Jackson Carlaw.
Yes, I think that is a very fair summary of the position and is very redolent of the experience of those who suffered from transvaginal mesh. It was a psychological condition, they were told, and not a real expression of pain and discomfort. Figures from Public Health Scotland and the Scottish Health Technologies Group suggest that there are around 10,500 hernia repairs carried out in Scotland each year. There may be some in the chamber, for all I know, and with mesh being used in approximately 62% of these procedures. And official statistics also suggest that there are an average of 32 procedures to remove mesh from previous hernia repairs each year. What is not yet available is data on the reasons why the mesh has been removed. And in comparison to the number of hernia repairs being carried out, these numbers may appear small. However, we must keep in mind that behind each of these statistics are individual patients. The committee also heard from the Chief Medical Officer that the complex mesh surgical service only deals with TVM removal, and there is no similar service for the removal of other types of mesh. And we heard of difficulties in getting mesh removal surgery on the NHS, which were attributed to a lack of knowledge about the issue in primary care. And the complex mesh surgical service only accepted gynaecological referrals. Some individuals resorted to going private to get their mesh removed, and some travelled abroad to do so. And we heard there's no clear pathway for patients, and GPs aren't aware of where to send patients. The testimony we received details the pain many individuals who have had mesh implanted during hernia or rectal prolapse repair surgery experienced. The people behind these statistics have told us that their symptoms occurred very quickly after surgery and have worsened over time. They've been left in constant pain. I apologise here. They have nerve damage, sexual pain, issues with their bladder and incontinence. One patient described the pain as feeling like a cheese grater being rubbed against my groin. Another patient told us the pain feels like they are wearing a tampon dipped in acid. Some people told the committee that they had been told that the hernia or rectal prolapse mesh had eroded into their vaginal wall, bowel and bladder, or adhered to their bladder, ovary, fallopian tube or bone. The committee heard that complications had led to mobility issues and had significantly reduced people's mental health and quality of life. Some people reported improvements after mesh removal surgery, but others were told that the mesh was too enmeshed in their body to be removed without causing serious ramifications, such as the loss of their rectum or testicles. A Scottish Government commissioned review on hernia mesh stated that most common adverse events following mesh-based hernia repair are pain, infection, hernia recurrence, scar tissue forming between separate surfaces of the body, and blockage of the bowel. The complications people are being forced to live with means that they have had to give up working, they have seen their relationships break down, and even something as simple as going out for a meal with their family has become impossible due to the pain they experience. They've told us of their concerns about informed consent, the point Mr. Cole Hamilton raised, and the challenges faced in having their pain taken seriously. In one case, we heard that a patient wasn't given any other choice of treatment. They were informed the surgery would involve mesh, and despite reporting pain in their hips, legs and pelvic area, they were met with a dismissive response from the surgeon. Similar stories have emerged throughout the submissions. Over and over, people told us they were either not informed mesh would be used, or if they were, the only risk would be that the mesh might be too tight, an issue that could be solved by snipping it. Unfortunately, the testimony we have heard clearly, and at times graphically, demonstrates that has not been the case. People have told us about developing autoimmune diseases, which they believe to have linked to having mesh inserted into their bodies. These were all themes we have explored with the Minister for Public Health over the course of two separate evidence sessions. And it was encouraging to hear from the Minister and also the Chief Medical Officer about the progress being made on embedded sharing decision-making as part of the patient journey. The Chief Medical Officer indicated that a shared decision-making approach has been wholeheartedly embraced by the profession and is supported by education delivered by the NHS. He told us that part of this approach includes sending letters to outpatients, encouraging them to engage with the clinical team and to ask questions on the benefits, risks, alternatives, and what happens if no action is taken. Yes, I will.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way, especially because I'm not sure that I won't be able to speak in the debate. And I think he's very clearly outlined the need that this issue goes much wider than mesh and used in transvaginal circumstances, but also I think in terms of looking at the wording of the motion, that it's actually the use of polyester and other materials more broadly, because others have been contacted by women who've had Esure devices fitted, who again have had very similar complications. So I was just wondering if the reassurances that we've been hearing from both ministers and medical officials extends to a broader category of devices, such as Esure devices, that have caused similar complications.
Jackson Carr.
I think Mr. Johnson raises a very valid point. I would say the evidence we have taken has been more directly in relation to the issues raised by the petition, but I think that he raises an important consideration, and I'd be interested to hear whether the Cabinet Secretary for Health can address that point too. The committee heard that surgical mesh has become the preferred method for hernia repair worldwide, with evidence suggesting that using mesh in hernia repair reduces recurrence. Nonetheless, a small minority of surgeons prefer to use natural tissue repair and will only revert to mesh as a last resort. And in that context, during our deliberations, we heard from experts at Shoulders Hospital in Canada For those who may not be familiar with this unique hospital, I would highlight that it is the only licensed hospital in the world dedicated to hernia repairs. We are particularly grateful to Dr. Fernando Spencer Neto, a surgeon at Shoulders, for taking the time to meet with the committee during a vital evidence session last May. And anyone who has viewed the evidence we heard from Shoulders cannot fail to be impressed by the results. Dr. Spencer Neto told us that they carry out 6,000 to 6,500 procedures each year, around 99% of which do not use mesh. The specialist focus on hernia repair and natural tissue repair has resulted in Shoulders having one of the lowest rates of hernia recurrence. Indeed, their recurrence rate is around 3 times lower than hospital with second lowest rate of recurrence. I can see, presiding officer, that I'm very close to the time to finish. So I will conclude with the words of one of the petitioners. Rosanna Clarkin told us, the Scottish Government have completely ignored us over the past 8 years. That's how they feel. We have campaigned alongside the transvaginal mesh women. We always knew we would have to fight for better health care together. This petition is our last chance to get what we feel should already have been in place. I'm pleased that the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee can play a part in ensuring that Rosanna, Lauren and all those who continue to campaign with them will hear their voice heard. And with that, presiding officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Carlo. I now call Hamza Youssef for around 9 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Jackson Carlo and the members of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee, and most importantly, perhaps, thank the petitioners, Rosanna, Lauren, and the other petitioners involved in this particular petition. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak on behalf of the government. I'm sure most members of this parliament are very familiar, and I know they are, in fact, very familiar with issues associated with surgical procedures which involve the use of transvaginal mesh, whether that is from our constituents, from the press, from the campaign that has been running, interestingly, for 10 years, as Jackson Carlo referenced in his own contribution. We've heard many of the distressing situations that those with complications have experienced. These have caused us all great concerns, and I'm very grateful, genuinely grateful, to all of those who have taken the time to open up and to speak very openly about their own experiences, something that is not easy at all, given the deeply personal nature of what they have faced. And we've heard some of that from Jackson Carlaw in the personal testimonies that he read out just a moment ago. Many of us here, as I say, first heard about mesh and surgery involving its use through the campaigning of those who had transvaginal mesh implants. I remain very grateful to that particular group of patients for making their voice heard, and it's a group of patients I continue to engage with. And the government has taken a wide range of action to assist those women who have been affected, and hopefully they have seen some progress, particularly over the course of the last 12 to 18 months. I propose in my remarks to today focus on those experiences of other types of mesh. It goes without saying, but I'll say it nonetheless, that I'm always very sorry to hear of those instances of complications and adverse effects, side effects in particular, and the impact that has had on individuals as well as their wider families. Alice Cole-Hamilton, I think, alluded to this point in his own intervention a moment ago. One of the striking common themes that has come out of engagement with the women affected by transvaginal mesh was that they simply were not believed. I don't want anybody here to think that the testimonies from those who've been affected by hernia mesh or other uses of mesh, who speak powerfully about the pain that it has caused them, I don't want them to think for one second that the government does not believe them or does not believe that their pain is real. And of course, if they have any, if they have ever felt that a clinician is not believing them, then that is not the trauma-informed, compassionate NHS that I believe in. Of course, I will give
Jackson Carlo.
I actually think politicians across this chamber, including the government, accept that that patients who have suffered in this way need to be believed. But Rona Mackay, a convener of the Cross Party on Chronic Pain, and I and others have heard repeatedly, unfortunately, from individuals who will tell you that that is not always the case in their experience when speaking to clinicians.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, of course, and I've heard that too, and I've engaged with those either involved, those suffer from chronic pain or indeed other conditions, and it's why some of the trauma-informed and compassionate leadership work that we're doing, I think, is so important. Equally, if there are instances of particular services where that seems where that approach is not taken, I'm always open to MSPs, to members of the public writing to me directly, communicating that with me directly, and I'll make sure that that is investigated from the government to that particular health board, or indeed to that particular service. And as I say, regardless of how mesh is used, whatever procedure it's used in, let me reiterate on behalf of the government that those individuals that suffer from side effects, from pain, from complication, they should get the care and the treatment that they need. And after hearing the concerns of patients, the government at the time commissioned the Scottish Health Technologies Group, as has already been referenced, to look into the issue of mesh in hernia repair. This led to the publication of not one but two reports on this subject. These reports are based on the information from peer-reviewed published evidence, much of this from comparative trial data. Both reports support the continued use of mesh in most abdominal wall and groin hernias. We've discussed these findings with professional bodies such as the relevant Royal Colleges and also the British Hernia Society, and we'll continue to work with them on this important issue. It's fair to say that they also support much of what is in the report from the Scottish Health Technologies Group in terms of the continued use of mesh. There is also work ongoing with regards to establishing registries, encouraging better data collection, which I think is a common theme from Jackson Carlaw's contribution. It will provide important surveillance and outcome information in years to come. I appreciate that petitioners would like an independent review of all surgical mesh and fixation devices to be undertaken, and that is entirely understandable in light of their own experiences. However, given the conclusions of the Scottish Health Technologies Group reports, the action that's been taken by us in response to those reports, which I'll touch on in more detail in just a moment, and given the various reviews carried out in relation to transvaginal mesh, I don't believe that a further review is warranted. We will, though, remain focused on available evidence, including new information as it emerges, and certainly from that data collection I spoke about a moment ago, and of course we're committed to acting upon it. So, of course I will, yes.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving me, and I note what he says about the kind of efficacy of a further review, but I think there is a growing global sense that actually the issues surrounding medical devices is a more broad one. I'm just wondering if you might comment on whether either devices that use polyester or other materials cited in the motion, or indeed more broadly, there's a revision in terms of the approach that taken to medical devices, given the global concern there is, not just particularly on mesh.
Cabinet Secretary.
What I would say is that the Scottish Health and Technologies Group looks at global evidence. It looks at that evidence that is available internationally. And what I would also say is that it's really important that we, and I think there's a lot of value in working on a four nations basis in relation to some of these issues, and that's why the Baroness Cumberland's report, for example, making progress on that, I think is so important. So where global evidence emerges on various different devices and the potential complications associated with them, that is why we have the Scottish Health Technologies Group to review that particular evidence where it exists. So I'm happy to take away the specific issue obviously Daniel Johnson raised and see if there's anything further that we may do in that regard. I am not making as much progress as I would like, but let me try to reiterate a couple of points, if I can, for emphasis. I do understand the reasons for suspension of the use of mesh that has been made by some of the petitioners, particularly this petition. What I would say is that there are some 100,000 hernia repairs carried out in the UK each year, approximately 11,000 of these in Scotland. That was in the year before the pandemic. And this includes elective procedures as well as those presenting as emergencies, and surgery must be available to all. I think establishing a specialist centre, which is again one of the suggestions within the petition, might not be conducive to this, as it would pull resources into potentially one health board area, meaning patients have to travel. Of course, there will be hernia repairs that are more complex, and it's for that reason that the Chief Medical Officer has asked medical directors to consider the development of local clinical groups and broader clinical networks for the management of more complex cases, and will continue to work with clinical colleagues in this. In the interim, however, is a patient's right to request a second opinion if they are in any doubt about the treatment being offered to them. In terms of, lastly, I will turn to address the issues, the continued use of mesh in other areas. In comparison to the use of mesh in hernia repair, these procedures are not performed frequently. Included in this is the use of mesh in reconstructive surgery and also continued use in gynaecology. In those cases, it's recognised that there are currently very few, frankly, any viable alternatives. So to suspend the use of mesh in the very wide way that's anticipated perhaps by the petitioners would unfortunately, I think, leave quite a wide cohort of people with limited or indeed no treatment options, which I'm sure is not the reality of what the petitioners would have wanted. I just wanted to end on the point, one of the points that Jackson Carlaw made, is that there was a number of recommendations from the reports and from the reviews that the Scottish Health and Technologies Group made, and they were about ensuring that any procedure is done in conjunction and in collaborative way with the patient involved, that they are fully appraised of the potential risks that there may well be to any surgery, and particularly including any surgery involving mesh, and that alternatives are explored if clinically viable and clinically safe to do so. So there is that exploration currently underway on the potential alternatives to mesh, particularly in hernia. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Parliament has quite rightly called on the Government to take steps for those who have been harmed in some cases, most notably in relation to transvaginal mesh. I think the Government has responded positively to that, but I do also conclude that in the wider sense sought by the petitioners, a further suspension review I don't think is warranted. In saying that, I completely understand the disappointment that some will feel, but I do hope the actions that I've set out here and that I will expand upon perhaps in my closing remarks give some reassurance that we're listening, we're making progress, and that we're absolutely committed to ensuring that people get the best care that they possibly need.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Sandus Gulhani. Dr. Gulhani, around 8 minutes, please.
Petitions by members of the public have brought about changes in law, in government policy, help revise guidelines on an issue, or even change a decision. Even just raising awareness of an issue in Parliament can be a success. We recognise the hard work of petitioners and those that are called on to give evidence and members of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee. While we often chide the Scottish Government over its lack of transparency or avoidance of scrutiny, which are essential for the functioning of our parliamentary system, we are also well aware that petitions process is important for our democracy. Petitioners, Rosanna Clarke and Lauren McDougall, have called on Parliament to suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices while a full review of all surgical procedures which use polyester, polypropylene or titanium is carried out and guidelines for the surgical use of mesh are established. This petition is not about transvaginal tape, TVT, or pelvic mesh implants. And Cabinet Secretary, in Health Committee today, we spoke about mesh implants, and you intimated there might be a bit of an update that you could give us today, and if possible, in your closing remarks, that would be great. But this petition is about mesh and other devices and fixations used in surgery elsewhere in the body, particularly in hernia repair. Their petition raised awareness of complications that have arisen from the use of synthetic mesh in surgical repairs. The petitioners also drew attention to concerns associated with titanium protacs that are used with hernia mesh, as these carry a cancer warning. Between May 21 and June 22, the committee heard evidence and received written submissions from an awful lot of people, including the chief surgeon of Canada's Shouldice Hospital, which is the only hospital in the world that is dedicated to hernia repair, performing up to 6,500 surgeries annually. We heard Jackson Carlaw talk about the complication rate, but it's very important to say the more you do one type of thing, the better you get at it and the less likely you are to have complications. I can't help but wonder how long patients have to wait to be seen at the Shouldice Hospital. I'm assuming it's better than NHS Grampian, where the longest recorded wait for a diagnostic test in 2022 was 258 weeks. As for surgery, while Shouldice is performing over 6,000 surgeries annually in our own country's largest health board, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, all non-urgent surgeries now pause. Likewise, in Ayrshire and Arran, the borders, and we understand NHS Fife is also reducing its elective surgical capacity. As a former registrar in a busy surgical department, I can say that surgery involves risk, and the risk increases if the patient's health is compromised, and this includes being overweight or obese. So it's important to examine the data from the outcome of many surgeries using a particular technique so as to evaluate any potential risk. If we take hernia repair, a hernia occurs when an internal part of the body pushes through a weakness in the muscle or surrounding wall, and a hernia then develops, and it's usually between chest and hips. An inguinal hernia repair can be carried out as either open surgery, which is essentially just a big cut, or laparoscopic, which is keyhole surgery. And once the anaesthetic has taken effect, the surgeon makes a single cut over the hernia. The incision is about 6 to 8 centimetres long. The surgeon then places the lump of fatty tissue or loop of bowel back into your abdomen, and mesh is then used to staple, or it's glued, into the place of the weakened area of the abdominal wall where the hernia came through to give it temporary strength while your body heals. And there have been reports of issues associated with mesh used in hernia repair, such as infection, pain, and adhesion. However, the Scottish Health Technologies Group reports that men operated with mesh were less likely to have hernia return compared to those having surgical stitches. Also, the use of mesh meant that men were less likely to suffer urinary retention, injury to nerves, blood vessels, or internal organs. They were more likely, though, to develop a build-up of fluid or swelling soon after surgery, which is common, and there was no difference of developing chronic pain whether stitches or mesh was used. So only a tiny percentage of hernia repairs involving mesh have had to have their mesh removed. And between 2013 and 2018, there are about 70 of these operations in Scotland to remove surgical mesh after hernia repair. And this represents about 0.3% of the 25,000 plus patients where mesh was used. In January 2020, the Scottish Health Technologies Group recommended that NHS Scotland use mesh when repairing hernias in adult men. They also stressed the importance of robust data collection, and data on long-term outcomes from hernia repair in Scotland are recorded at a national level to inform further decision-making.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thanks, Anish Galhani, for taking intervention. We're talking about mesh, and would you agree that the properties of mesh, like the type of filament, the tensile strength, the porosity, there's so much choice in the mesh that's implanted that maybe the data that we get from that might help us determine which mesh leads to specific complications like pain?
Dr. Galhani.
It's almost like Emma's read the rest of my speech. But yes, I would agree. The National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, which we all know is NICE, has found that post-operative complications from mesh surgery were rare. And I must say, in my experience in hospitals, mesh complications were rare. And I'm probably the only person here to have actually implanted mesh into hernias. Emma Harper says she's put them in as well. From a systemic review of literature covering 37 randomised controlled trials, which totaled 5,560 participants, and that's quite a lot, 10% or less experienced persistent pain from either procedure, and 23% or less experienced persistent numbness.
Will my colleague take an intervention?
Yes.
Jackson Carlo.
I mean, I've now heard Dr. Galhani say that he has inserted mesh into other people. Were he diagnosed with a hernia repair, would his preference be to have mesh inserted into him or a natural tissue repair?
Sounds good, honey.
My preference would be what the surgeon deemed to be the most appropriate for me. And if that involved the surgeon saying that he thinks or she thinks that mesh would be the correct procedure, then I would wholeheartedly go forward with that, because it depends upon the hernia that I have. But I don't have a problem with having mesh implanted into myself or into my family. NICE guidelines recommend future research into chronic pain and numbness, as well as setting up a registry to monitor adverse events and recurrence rates. As for the petitioner's cancer concerns, the US Food and Drugs Administration reviewed early epidemiological studies on implanted hemopoietic cancers and found conflicting evidence, but only two studies suggested an increased risk of lymphoma or leukemia. And this is a really important thing to say here. No medical or surgical intervention is without its side effects. And considering the evidence taken by the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee, We do not support this petition. And let me explain with another example. Andy Murray won his first round of the Australian Open earlier today, which is quite frankly amazing, given he has a metal hip. But actually, he doesn't have a total hip replacement. He has a hip resurfacing. And when I was working in London under Professor Haddad, there was a scandal around hip resurfacing, and there was calls for the procedure to be banned completely. But what we discovered is this is actually a fantastic piece of kit if it's inserted by the right surgeon on the right patient. And Andy Murray shows you the value of this procedure when it's done right. So what I'm saying, not all kinds of mesh are the same, not all patient indications are the same, and most evidence points towards hernia mesh being much safer than transvaginal mesh. We do not support calls from the Scottish... We do, however, support calls from the Scottish Health Technologies Group. I think the presiding officer would tell me to wrap up at this point. We do have a support calls from the Scottish Health Technologies Group to strengthen data collection on hernia outcomes and from NICE to monitor adverse effects. I declare my interests as a practising NHS GP.
Thank you, Dr. Gulhani. I now call Jackie Bailey for around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I apologise to the Chamber in advance? With your permission, I will need to leave briefly during the course of the debate to undertake an interview, but I will return and make sure I catch up with my colleagues' contributions. Let me start by thanking the Public Petitions Committee for their work on this petition and to commend Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall for bringing the petition to the Scottish Parliament. This petition is about suspending the use of mesh, other devices and fixings used in surgery, and in particular in hernia repairs. Some 11,000 hernia procedures are carried out in the four-year period, five times as many as were carried out for pelvic or transvaginal mesh. But problems that have been reported include infection, pain, and adhesion to other parts of the body. And there are clear similarities in the experiences of people who have had hernia operations with women who have had transvaginal mesh implanted. And there are lessons that the Scottish Government must learn from the campaign to suspend the use of transvaginal mesh in 2014 and the unacceptably long time that campaigners have been forced to wait for treatment and for solutions. People who have experienced problems with mesh are often left in crippling pain. They've suffered from multiple organ trauma and extensive nerve damage, despite being told that the mesh causing them this pain was safe. We know that their pain went ignored by some health professionals because they've told us so, and dismissed as somehow being all in their minds. Many of the circumstances and the language that was used during the fight about transvaginal mesh is being replicated now in discussions around the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices. People with lived experience have spoken about the excruciating pain they are forced to endure and how this has led to depression and sometimes suicidal thoughts. They tell how they've been ignored and shrugged off by doctors when reporting their symptoms or attributing pain to their mesh implants. This pain impacts upon their ability to work or enjoy any quality of life. In the evidence they gave to the Public Petitions Committee, patients have detailed how the prolapse mesh they've been fitted with has eroded into the walls of their body or even adhered to their organs. And similar to the experience of the women who are fitted with transvaginal mesh, there are currently few processes in place for addressing and removing surgical mesh that is defective. There's a lack of process around the tracing of the product, which makes it hard to retrieve faulty mesh that has been fitted. And whilst I welcome the establishment of a medical device information system, it is genuinely concerning that nearly 10 years after transvaginal mesh survivors brought these issues to the fore, such a system is still not in place. The Scottish Government do need to work to rectify this as a matter of urgency. I give a cautious welcome to the two Scottish Health Technology reports that make recommendations about the conditions for the continued use of mesh. But I believe that patients must have choice in their treatment, and note that in some countries, like Canada, they no longer use mesh at all. Mesh has been banned there since 2019. Now, what do they know that we don't? And I also agree with the petitioners that there needs to be a specialist mesh removal service. Currently, the complex mesh surgical service deals only with transvaginal mesh removal. The waiting time to be seen is currently sitting at 42 weeks, and then there is the time to wait for treatment. I have a constituent, Maureen, who has faced months of cancelled appointments before finally being scanned at the Glasgow Clinic in November 2021. She'd been told that there were no issues with her mesh, yet a private scan, which she organised for peace of mind, confirmed it was twisted and the cause of her pain. Maureen lost her job due to the complications from her mesh surgery. She's been failed by the government multiple times. The minister can't tell us how many have been referred to specialists in England or the US, or how long that will take. I understand Dr. Veronicus has only treated 10 women and his contract runs out this summer. There appears to be a reluctance to refer to the preferred operations that these women want. And I've previously raised the case of Anne, who's been to America for treatment with Dr. Veronicus, and ministers saying that there was no cap on the amount which could be claimed, and Anne's experience is entirely different. Despite the minister saying there was no cap, Anne is still fighting to be compensated for the full cost of her flights. The service established to address the serious problems faced by transvaginal mesh survivors is welcome, but it's not being resourced adequately. If we are to include other types of surgical mesh removal, then its operation needs to be urgently reviewed and the scope expanded. We have a duty, Presiding Officer, to get this right for all those who have experienced negative side effects because of surgical mesh. The experiences and stories of these people heard by the committee are not isolated. They are widespread and they are real. The government must learn from this testimony and prevent history from repeating itself.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bailey. And I call Alex Cole Hamilton for around 6 minutes. Mr. Cole Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. It gives me great pleasure to rise for my party in support of the motion of the Petitions Committee. I have raised this several times in connected debates about the use of transvaginal mesh implants in terms of the fact that we needed to expand the debate and the discussion to the use of mesh in other parts of the body. I'm very gratified by the work of the petitioners Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall for the work that they've done to get us to this point. It's a long time coming. Last year I shared a story of my constituent Cathy, whose account echoed those of hundreds of other women who were referred to their GPs and a physiotherapist to receive a mesh implant. Cathy was given very little information other than being told that the procedure would alleviate the mild incontinence that she was suffering. What followed was 5 years of crippling pain with Cathy's mobility, mental health, intimacy with her partner, all suffering. Presiding Officer, put simply, her quality of life was devastated. I and my party were proud to back the legislation passed by this Parliament almost a year ago to reimburse the victims of transvaginal mesh implants for the surgery that they would have to undergo to have it removed privately. Although nothing can take away from the trauma that they have had to endure, at least they did not have to bear the hefty financial cost of having the implant removed, and at least their plight and their injuries were recognised by this place. However, that legislation was far from a panacea and it was incomplete. That reimbursement scheme did not include the victims of other mesh implants, for instance, those who have suffered complications with hernia mesh. And we have heard somewhat graphically some of the descriptions of those cases. And Presiding Officer, that's why I was one of the first to raise hernia mesh in this chamber, along with a number of other MSPs, because we've all met constituents, probably all met constituents to whom this applies. One of my constituents was effectively left crippled by her hernia mesh. There are also harrowing accounts of the impact of hernia mesh implants, including a patient who was left with an actual gaping wound in her side, in the side of her stomach, which cannot be healed properly, which prevents her from travelling, from going out and visiting her children who live far away. Despite accounts like this, hernia mesh implants are still widely used. And today we have before us a petition which seeks to address this and to look towards the suspension of the use of surgical mesh and fixation devices while a review is conducted into their use and all surgical procedures which implant any form of polyester, polypropylene or titanium products. I will from Dr. Gilhani.
Sanders Gilhani.
As the member well knows, there are lots of people who are waiting for hernias and they're not emergencies, but they need to be done. So what would we do for them?
Alex Cole Hamilton.
Well, I think an anxiety I have about the approach of the medical profession in some cases is to rush into a decision and to bounce patients into treatment without fully informing of the risks or possible side effects of that intervention. If mesh is not a safe intervention, it's not a solution to the problems that Dr. Gilhani outlines. And, Presiding Officer, I've met so many survivors of both transvaginal and now hernia mesh, and having heard so many tragic and life-changing stories, I do have an immediate and visceral problem with this or similar material being implanted into anyone's body. Personally, I would like to see compelling evidence of the safety of any mesh implant before I would ever be comfortable recommending it to someone I know or taking it myself. And I am aware of the reports of the Scottish Health Technology Groups which support the continued use of mesh in abdominal wall and hernia situations, provided there is a shared decision-making and informed consent process with an awareness of risk being imparted to the patient. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm not persuaded that that is actually happening. And we have heard, and I intervened on Jackson Carlaw to say, and he agreed with me, that doesn't always happen, that informed consent. Giving patients the agency, crediting them with the facts and the risks, is not always happening. And if were it to happen, I think several people may take different decisions and we would see a shift in the balance away from it. I'm also mindful of the concern that suspending the use of hernia mesh could leave some people with no or very limited treatment options. That needs to be taken into account, and we have to be cognizant of it. As reflected in the petition, I think it a credit again the petitioners for the elegant way in which they put it to us. There are some life or death cases where, of course, the use of a mesh or some surgical implant is definitely essential. Presiding Officer, what many of the cases of transvaginal mesh had in common was the failure of those providing treatment to make those patients fully aware of the potential risks involved in using those implants. Informed consent is one of the key principles and pillars of our health service, or at least it should be, and it is right that every patient be given all of the information about what their treatment involves. That's realistic medicine. That's treating people like grown-ups. That must include the potential risks as well as the benefits. And whilst patients must always be offered reasonable alternative treatments wherever possible. In this case, it's also important that we ensure health boards are provided with all that they need to ensure the availability of non-mesh surgery and that any skills gaps that impact the treatment of complex cases are addressed. I also agree, may I say, with Jackie Bailey, excellent point, I think, about the urgent and pressing need for mesh removal care pathways to happen in the Scottish NHS. We need to build in the capacity and the expertise to make that happen here in Scotland. Finally, Presiding Officer, I'm not a clinician, that's clear. And it is, of course, right that scrutiny is provided in decisions taken by specialists. The first step in that process is hearing the lived experience of those who have suffered from complications. We must remember that many survivors of vaginal mesh implants describe not being taken seriously and even being told they were imagining their pain. It's a theme that's echoed throughout this debate. In fact, Rosanna, one of the people who brought forward today's petition, sadly has a similar story. She even had to deal with her GP suggesting that the pain that she was experiencing was all in her head. It's only by listening to people like her that we will do the due diligence we need to do to around the long-term effects of these materials, what they have on the body, and get a full picture to ensure that nobody else is harmed.
Thank you, Mr. Cole Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call first Rona Mackay to be followed by Megan Gallagher for around 6 minutes. Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today we're debating an issue that has been highlighted many times over the years in this chamber, 10 years, as Jackson Carlaw said, and it's one I've taken a keen interest in. Thankfully, now there is a ban on transvaginal mesh implants brought in by former Health Secretary Jean Freeman, and it was warmly welcomed by campaigners and their families. Jackson Carlaw, whose motion we're debating today, former MSPs Neil Findlay and Alex Neil were at the forefront of the fight for justice for women and spearheaded the campaign for women victims of mesh. Last year, the Scottish Government passed legislation to establish a £1 million fund to support women affected by mesh complications who'd received implants in the NHS but had to travel abroad to have them removed by an experienced clinician. We thankfully now have a facility in Glasgow with specially trained surgeons where mesh removal can be carried out. So the scandal of women in Scotland and indeed globally whose lives have been ruined by transvaginal mesh will go down in history as one of the worst medical injustices for decades. However, in all honesty, this debate surrounding Petition 1865, you know, has left me a bit confused. I am sympathetic to it. I probably feel more confused now having listened to Jackson Carlow and then to Sandesh Gohani, who clearly don't agree on it, but there are good points made in everybody's speeches that they've made so far. So essentially, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices while a review of all the surgical procedures which use polyester, polypropylene or titanium is carried out and guidelines for the surgical use of mesh are established. It acknowledges that mesh must be used in life or death situations but adds the caveats that mesh is only used when essential, patients have alternatives to mesh and mesh has to be used with the fully informed consent of the patient. And the petitioners want the use of mesh devices and stitches to be suspended while a review of all surgical procedures which implant any form of the materials I just mentioned, for example, hernia mesh, rectal mesh, mesh used in hysterectomies, is carried out and guidelines for the use of surgical mesh are established. And they're calling for the suspension of the use of titanium protacs and claim these carry a cancer warning. But crucially, the petition also recognises and supports women with TVT or pelvic mesh implants and acknowledges that what we're talking about is not the same. Presiding Officer, I'm not a clinician, and neither are the majority of us in this chamber, with notable exceptions. My opposition to the use of women receiving mesh implants was based on hundreds of testimonies from women who'd suffered life-changing injuries. However, with regard to the type of mesh which is used, which is the subject of this petition, as I've said, even the petitioners acknowledge that it is different from TVT. And the fact is that many people have had mesh for hernia inserted and successfully, and I don't know the data for those who have reported ill effects. And I think data is absolutely key to this issue, and I would welcome and I would hope to learn more about that. Presiding Officer, the obvious statement to make is that a review would cause a delay for patients getting treatment at a time when, as we all know, delays are prevalent due to the intense and unprecedented pressure on the NHS. A review would take time to set up and to come to a conclusion, and this would surely leave medics and patients in limbo. The petitioners asked that mesh is only used when essential. Well, surely a surgeon would not use it unless he deemed it essential. They ask that patients have alternatives to mesh, and I'm unclear if how many of us know what options there are available to surgeons to treat hernias and other conditions. And they ask that mesh is only used with the fully informed consent of the patient. One of the stipulations since the scandal of TVT mesh is that patients do have fully informed choice, and that should be the norm for any surgical procedure being undertaken. And I take on board, though, what Alex Cole-Hamilton has said. The petitioners also acknowledge that mesh must be used in a life or death situation. I would suggest that only clinicians know the severity of any situation and they'd make the correct choice to keep the patient alive. Presiding Officer, the mesh scandal, where many hundreds of women in Scotland and many more throughout the world, has been a long and very difficult journey for those affected by the devastating symptoms and side effects which have been life-changing. We've come a long way in 10 years, admittedly at a much slower pace than it should have taken, to stop women being affected in this way, and this has been acknowledged by the medical profession. The bottom line for me, Presiding Officer, is that my issue with this petition, which is undoubtedly well-intentioned and heartfelt, is that I simply don't know if there's justification for it. I'm not sure that the majority of us do, and I'm just saying that there's uncertainty here which could have unintended consequences. But I agree with the previous speakers, we must listen to the petitioners and what they've been experiencing. But my concern is that many patients would face delayed treatment or less effective treatment were this petition to be upheld. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mackay. And I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Emma Harper. Around 6 minutes, Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I begin by recognising the many women and men who have come forward to discuss deeply personal accounts of their life-changing and lifelong consequences that mesh surgery can cause. Reliving this trauma must be difficult, but it gives MSPs the opportunity to pause, reflect and review treatments offered to people across Scotland. Also to those who have campaigned vigorously to ensure that any procedure involving mesh is low risk and appropriate. In all of our considerations today, when mentioning the use of such devices, it is people's health, safety and well-being that must be our first concern. And the petition that we're debating today, if approved by this Parliament, would suspend all surgical mesh and fixation devices. I have some sympathy towards those who have submitted this petition to the Petitions Committee, given the serious implications transvaginal mesh had had on many women globally. Mesh was previously used to treat stress urinary incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse in women. However, in 2014, a petition was submitted on behalf of the Scottish Mesh Survivors Hear Our Voice campaign. We have all heard the harrowing stories, some this afternoon, from women who have bravely told their stories, how they were told that they were just experiencing women's problems and that there was nothing seriously wrong. And taking the time to read some of their accounts helped me understand the distrust that women felt towards the government and our NHS for not being believed. It was right that the Scottish Transvaginal Mesh Implants Independent Review from 2017 recommending stopping this surgery after concerns were raised by women who suffered debilitating, severe and painful consequences. Thankfully, there are now specialised services in Scotland for women who have experienced complications from mesh implant surgery. And the Scottish Government officially signed a contract which allows women to have painful mesh implants removed by specialist surgeons in the United States free of charge. This deal allows NHS patients in Scotland to travel to Dr. Veronica's clinic in Missouri for transvaginal mesh removal surgery, and another with Spire Healthcare, where Professor Hashim operates, was also agreed earlier this year, giving women the option to go to Bristol for this surgery, although the points that Jackie Bailey raised during her contribution is concerning. And I don't think I'll be the only MSP in the chamber today who wish that the government acted sooner and more efficiently to support women who had this type of surgery. But one takeaway from the whole debacle was that MSPs from across the political chamber rallied together to ensure that mesh survivors not only had a clear route of treatment, but were also compensated if they'd spent thousands of pounds of their own money to have the implant removed. And as my colleague, Dr. Sandesh Gulhani, and others have articulated, there is more than one type of surgical mesh. There appears to be some kind of evidence that points to similar issues to transvaginal mesh and other kinds such as hernia. Potential complications include chronic pain, bowel obstruction, hernia reoccurrence and infection. And as these concerns have been raised, the need for data and evidence is essential when investigating the link between cause and treatment. For example, only a tiny percentage of hernia repairs involving people have had to have their mesh removed. And the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence found that post-operative complications from mesh were rare, so I do believe that we need to be careful when looking at mesh and any side effects of having this kind of surgery. Moving on to the petition itself, the foundation... Yes, certainly.
Emma Harper.
I thank Megan Gallen for taking an intervention. Does the member agree that anyone who is experiencing complications of inguinal hernia repair or any mesh implant should be looked after by caring, compassionate and kind and competent multidisciplinary team? This is something that we really need to make sure that we move forward and consider.
Megan Gallen.
Certainly, I think you know that anyone you know experiencing any kind of pain should be you know treated with you know utmost care, respect, dignity. I think that's something that any patient that approaches any service within the NHS should expect. And I do agree with Emma Harper that we should always look at these scenarios and make sure that we're moving in a positive and forward-thinking direction. But moving on to the petition itself, the foundation behind this campaign is that petitioners believe that surgical mesh can lead to cancer. It also calls for mesh to only be used in life and death circumstances and for a full review into how surgical mesh is used. Presiding Officer, this is why, and others have outlined the importance of evidence-based arguments because, and my colleague Sandesh Gulhani mentioned this earlier as well, official sources such as the US Food and Drug Administration said that they are sceptical of mesh leading to cancer. Therefore, more evidence would need to be supplied in order to look at this petition further. But this being said, I won't speak against any individual's own personal experience of mesh implications, but I do believe that all avenues must be investigated should they experience any of the issues outlined by transvaginal and hernia mesh victims. Presiding Officer, if I may, before I finish today's contribution, I do want to bring up hospital waiting lists as they will undoubtedly impact people who are experiencing any symptoms that could come with mesh surgery. At present, many people can't see a GP, be seen at A&E within 4 hours, or get through to the phone on NHS 24. This, combined with budget cuts and NHS staff shortages, is deepening the crisis that has emerged in our healthcare service. And if the government doesn't get to grips with hospital waiting times, people will continue to suffer unnecessarily due to the pressures on our NHS and the lack of action from the government. So we on this side of the chamber will continue to hold the SNP Green government to account to ensure that improvements are made to our healthcare service. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. And I call Emma Harper to be followed by Katie Clark for around 6 minutes. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm speaking in this debate today as there's 2 points that I want to make, and I've got some additional info as well now after hearing everybody else. Firstly, as a former operating room nurse here in Scotland, England and in California, I have experience of hernia or an inguinal hernia repairs and other hernia surgery using surgical mesh. I've seen the amazing results achieved with repair of anatomical defects fixed using mesh. Surgical mesh is a crucial tool for surgery. And secondly, Presiding Officer, and notwithstanding this, I completely understand the chronic and serious and total distress that complications have occurred for some women, and they've experienced that as a result of transvaginal mesh. I was a Health Committee member in the last session when the legislation was taken forward in order that we deal with the transvaginal approach. The testimony that we heard from the women that had complications was extremely powerful, as were the campaigning efforts of the survivors, and I again put my thanks on the record for them. Anyone experiencing mesh complications must be listened to with kindness, compassion and caring. They need to have a great team of health professionals, and it actually distresses me to hear that some folk have had their pain ignored. So I, of course, welcome the steps that the Scottish Government have put in place to allow women to take whichever course of action is most suitable to them for their mesh complications so that they can be rectified. And I look forward to updates from the Cabinet Secretary on how the complex mesh surgical service is progressing. Presiding Officer, recent studies, including from the Royal College of Surgeons, suggest that the risk of chronic pain following an inguinal hernia repair is similar regardless of whether mesh is used. Prior to the use of mesh in hernia surgery, recurrence rates of herniorrhaphy were extremely high, 10 to 20% in some studies, and there is little doubt that mesh use has dramatically improved statistics and outcomes for patients. According to the Royal College of Surgeons, most of the negative coverage of surgical mesh has focused on post-operative pain issues, and they say that there is a danger that the coverage may be taken out of context. We know that original reports of mesh complications featured gynaecology surgery, which is entirely different to patients having a groin or other abdominal hernia repair. And Presiding Officer, in the report published by the Scottish Health Technologies Group, there are a number of recommendations for the NHS Scotland to take forward, which are underpinned by evidence. The clinical evidence supports the continued use of surgical mesh as a choice and an option for elective repair of primary ventral hernias, incisional hernias and primary inguinal hernias in adults in Scotland. While patient preference may be for a non-mesh or suture-only repair, access to alternative hernia management options should be available. Obviously, this depends on the patient, the size of the defect, even the size of the patient, the assessment, the diagnosis, the specific surgical or non-surgical recommendations that need to be made. The report makes clear that all elective hernia repairs should be preceded by a detailed discussion between the patient and the surgeon as part of an informed consent process. I agree with Alec Cole-Hamilton on that. It is important to ensure that the discussions include the benefits and risks of surgical and non-surgical approaches to hernia management, including the fact that neither mesh or non-mesh repair, such as suture, are risk-free procedures. We need to make sure also the risk of developing chronic pain following a hernia repair, especially for patients with pain as their main presenting symptom, is also put forward to the patient. The communication is absolutely crucial in enabling patients to make informed consent decisions on their treatment options. And the decision to use laparoscopic or open mesh repair should be based on the patient's medical history, the characteristics of their hernia, and the surgeon's expertise as well. In addition, it's worth... making sure I turn the right page. In addition, we need to make sure that it's crucial to monitor the effectiveness of surgical mesh data. Data on long-term outcomes from henna repair in Scotland must be recorded at a national level to inform future decision-making. It must be aligned with the UK's medical device information system and should include collection of patient-reported outcomes. I would welcome an update from the Cabinet Secretary on whether this data will be collected or is it being collected and how will it be reported. In addition, it is worth noting that the NICE guidelines also recommend laparoscopic surgery as one of the treatment options for the repair of inguinal hernia. And again, it depends on whether it's unilateral or bilateral. Again, it's about assessment and diagnosis of the patient. Section 1.2 of the guidance of the NICE guidance states that to enable patients to choose between open and laparoscopic surgery, either by the transabdominal preperitoneal or totally extraperitoneal procedure, that's my favourite by the way, patients should be fully informed of all of the risks. And we know that international guidelines for groin hernia management developed by the Hernia Surge Group show that they conducted a thorough review of hernia repairs, leading to 136 statements, 88 recommendations for the best practice approach to hernia repair, and it's worth exploring their evidence and guidelines. And last Thursday, Presiding Officer, I spoke with Dr. David Saunders, consultant upper GI surgeon in Devon Hospital in Barnstaple. He is the president of the British Hernia Society, and he gave me lots of info to take forward. So, in closing, Presiding Officer, I'd be interested in whether, at closing from the deputy convener of the committee, that they will seek input from the British Hernia Society as we move forward, because one of their members is right on our doorstep here in Edinburgh. And in closing, I thank the petitioners for bringing this issue to Parliament, but I repeat that any decisions that we take forward must be based on best available clinical data and evidence. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Siobhan Brown, around 6 minutes. Ms Clark.
Presiding Officer, and I want to thank the petitioners, Rosanna Clarkin, who is a mesh injured woman who has suffered chronic debilitating pain and life-altering injury after a procedure for a hernia, and Lauren McDougall, whose mother, Michelle McDougall, suffered 18 years of pain as a result of a surgical mesh procedure before dying of a rare cancer. Neither Rosanna nor Michelle had given consent to mesh being used. Having met with both Rosanna and Lauren, I know the pain and damage that mesh has caused in their lives and how they are seeking the support they deserve from the Scottish Government. Rosanna and Lauren have met with a number of politicians, but they have not met with the Cabinet Secretary, and I would ask that he consider meeting with them to hear of their experiences firsthand. I asked Rosanna Clarkin what her top ask would be for the debate today, and she said that it was patient pathways to be provided for all who were mesh injured, rather than each individual having to fight for medical support. The petition that they have put before this Parliament is backed by powerful testimonies from over 70 mesh patients and their families. It is clear on what action they are asking from the Scottish Government. We need to accept that people are still having mesh implanted in Scotland, and I would argue that the Scottish Government must suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices whilst an independent review takes place. Mesh is a cheaper option, but there are other options available, and it was skin and indeed pig skin that the petitioners believed would have been used in their procedures. The Scottish Government must provide greater healthcare support for patients who are mesh injured. They must increase access to specialist care, including mesh removal surgery and alternative treatments. And I believe I will give way to the member.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. I'm busy on my feet this afternoon, presiding officer, but it's a really interesting subject for me. Would Katie Clark agree that it might be worth exploring what they're doing with the one-stop shop clinic in Barnstaple at Devon, because they have the whole pathway sorted for one-stop shop clinic for chronic management of pain for mesh repairs?
Katie Clark.
I'm very grateful for that helpful intervention. And yes, we should look at what's happening there, and indeed we should look at what's happening around the world. And Jathy Bailey has already pointed to the decision in Canada to suspend the use of mesh. But I believe that the Scottish Government must apologise for their failure to act to date on the concerns of mesh patients and establish a compensation scheme to support these individuals as they attempt to overcome the pain and damage which mesh has caused them. Many of the campaigners on this issue are now living with life-changing conditions which are directly linked to the mesh procedures that they underwent. Whilst transvaginal mesh and its complications affected the lives of so many women, as we've heard, the use of other mesh products to treat conditions like hernias affect women, men and sometimes children too. But despite the testimonies that the Public Petitions Committee received from patients affected by the use of mesh, the true extent of the damage caused by these products remains unclear, and indeed there have been a number of calls in this debate already for more data and for evidence to be obtained. In her evidence to the Public Petitions Committee back in June, the Minister admitted that it was not easy to trace what products had been used in all procedures and which were causing harm. Yet, despite this lack of regulation on its use, NHS Scotland continues to use mesh in surgical procedures. From 2016 to 2020, 62% of all hernia repairs carried out by NHS Scotland used mesh. And that's why I join campaigners in their call for an independent review of mesh and fixation devices. We cannot establish the true scale of the damage that these mesh products have caused in the lives of so many patients across Scotland until we get the data and until we get the evidence. And until that review is completed, the Scottish Government must order health boards to suspend the use of surgical mesh and fixation devices and use other procedures. So we need to put protections in place for patients. And there needs to be clear guidelines to be sent out governing the surgical use of mesh. I believe that we need to suspend the use of mesh, but there may well be situations where it's essential and there's no other alternatives available. But that must only happen when patients have given their informed consent to its use. And it's disturbing that so many petitioners did not give that consent. I'm very grateful to the Petitions Committee for giving us the time to explore these issues today. And I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will agree to meet with the petitioners to take forward the issues that are being raised in this debate.
Thank you, Ms Clark. I now call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Brian Whittle. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Brown.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I've mentioned in this chamber numerous times the experience of one of my constituents who received a transvaginal mesh implant. She shared with me her story, which she described as a 12-year nightmare of excruciating pain. Her continual pain had a knock-on effect in all aspects of her life, including her career and her family. And I note that this petition we're considering today is not explicitly about transvaginal mesh, but mesh used in surgery elsewhere. And the reason I mention this experience of my constituent is because as I was reading the story of Rosanna Clarkin, one of the petitioners, it echoed what my constituent went through, that all-encompassing pain can really have a devastating effect on your life. And I'd like to thank Rosanna and Lauren McDougall for bringing this petition to members. It's given us a chance to speak about this really important issue and hear other people's stories. It is clear that the Minister for Public Health and the Cabinet Secretary for Health are taking this issue seriously and listening to concerns as well as the evidence. I do believe, given the statements issued by the Scottish Government and the scientific research available, it would not be wise to call for a suspension of surgical mesh in other parts of the body. And as we've heard, mesh is routinely used in hernia surgery, and around five times as many hernia mesh procedures have been carried out as pelvic mesh or TVT implants in Scotland. And further to this, hernia repairs are one of the most common surgeries carried out globally. As with any surgery, this carries risks and side effects, and the Scottish Government commissioned research into the use of mesh in a commonly performed hernia repair. This resulted in the publication of the Scottish Health Technologies Group report on the use of mesh in primary hernia repair in adult males. And the report concluded that compared to non-mesh procedures, using mesh resulted in lower rates of recurrence, fewer serious adverse events, and similar of lower risk of chronic pain. A further report by the group found that evidence supports the continued option of using surgical mesh in hernia repair. And as the Minister has previously stated, the use of mesh in operations is long established, and in situations there are very few, if any, viable alternatives. Therefore, the suspension of mesh treatments would leave people at this stage with no other options. There is also a very important point that has been raised by the petitioners and the government and the research bodies, and that is of informed consent. It's been reported in the media that Rosanna was not told her operation would involve the use of mesh, and she did not find out until much later that mesh was actually used. I obviously can't comment on specifics of this case of what happened, but it's unthinkable that something like that could actually happen. I agree with the Minister and the healthcare professionals that, with the exception of emergency procedures, the use of mesh should only be carried out with the fully informed consent of the patient, who understands the potential risks and the other options that are available to them. And I know that the Chief Medical Officer wrote to Health Board directors in 2018 to highlight the importance of informed consent. And if I could ask the Cabinet Secretary in his closing speech to confirm that informed consent is still being highlighted across the health boards in relation to mesh surgery. Let me draw my conclusions to an end, and I completely understand that some of the members of the public who signed this petition will be disappointed that mesh surgeries are going ahead. I trust that the communications from the Scottish Government and healthcare professionals will give reassurance and the reasons behind this. Fundamentally, it's crucial that we listen to the people who have suffered from mesh surgery complications. My constituent wasn't listened to. Rosanna was dismissed at first and told her pain was in her head. I'm sure there'll be many others with this experience. Only by continuing to listen to people with lived experience can we ensure that we start the important process of supporting any person that needs this type of surgery and get the best possible care in place for the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Brown. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Emma Roddick. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate today. I think the mesh issue has been in the Petitions Committee agenda since my arrival in this place, and it's fair to say it's delivered some of the most harrowing of evidence sessions I have been involved with my time here. It certainly focused my mind on the fact that what we do in this place, amid all the other white noise of political discourse, has a profound effect on the lives of people in Scotland. And in the case of this debate today, a topic that has had a far wider reach and implications than just within our borders. I also wanted to say, Deputy Presiding Officer, in a particular evidence session at the site of the Cabinet Secretary and the Chief Medical Officer being cross-examined in Committee Room 1 by committee members and former members, with so many women affected by this procedure sat behind them, many in wheelchairs. It's a vivid one. And every time I step into Committee Room 1, I always remember that picture. The fact that the then committee was joined by the now convener, Jackson Carlow, Alex Neil and Neil Findlay, highlights the cross-party support for this campaign. And I would like to put on record that the undaunting pursuit of this issue by my colleagues, Jackson Carlow, and previous colleagues, Alex Neil and Neil Findlay, was so important in arriving at a solution for the petition of such a harrowing issue. Without their determination and effort, it is unlikely we would get to where we are now. And considering the time it took to get there, Deputy Presiding Officer, remembering I've been involved for nearly 7 years, and that's way short of my other colleagues, for such an acute issue, that it seems ridiculous to me that, firstly, it took so long to make the government move on this and accept there was a major problem, and secondly, here we are again discussing similar issues and trying to ensure that similar outcomes that we require are realised. Having said that, and given the recent political discourse, it does restore a bit of my faith in this Parliament that we can effect change for the good of the country if we do come together across this chamber. I would also like to add my, again, sincere gratitude to the Scottish Mass Survivors campaign Hear Our Voice for their unrelenting and resolute campaigning to try and ensure that what they have had to endure was spoken in a public forum, and that their desire that no one else need have their lives devastated by potential repercussions of the use of mesh. This campaign also highlights the national and international impact that a public campaign can have through the Petitions Committee vehicle. Back then, there were questions to be answered. Firstly, how a former Health Secretary, Alex Neil, can take the robust action of imposing a moratorium on the use of transvaginal mesh only for certain health boards to continue to use the procedure to treat stress and urinary incontinence. I think there were some 400 women undergoing this procedure since that moratorium. Who was ensuring the moratorium was adhered to? Who was responsible? Rules cannot be set if there is no system of enforcement. It was news to me and many other MSPs, apparently as well as the campaigners, that a moratorium called for by the government is not binding. This has to be an area of concern, something I think the Parliament is still to address. Had that moratorium held, I don't think we'd be in the position we found ourselves in. I also want to say that the involvement of the MHRA was absolutely shocking. A body in whom we place a great deal of trust and responsibility has been exposed as inadequate and incapable of applying any degree of logic or care. In fact, claiming that the sufferer's pain could be psychosomatic. No duty of care and candour. It was painful watching the chair of the review squirm in the chair under questioning during the evidence session, her answers causing gasps from the woman seated behind her. A lack of empathy and understanding was all too evident. So given the language used at the time from certain clinicians around "it's all in your head," as highlighted by Jackson Carlow on behalf of the committee, and the way in which that kind of language really slowed up the process of getting to that moratorium in the first place and the subsequent positive results for the transvaginal mesh petitioners, it is a worry to hear that that kind of language is creeping back into similar concerns from the men who have had or are considering mesh implants for hernia repair. And as we know, men are not so good at talking about health issues and certainly more reticent to organise themselves the way women mesh survivors did and to push for justice in the way that they did. We would all want to avoid a similar situation down the line where we are taking evidence from a group of men suffering from the misuse of a similar procedure. I think one of the key elements for me that came out of the initial petition was the lack of discussion around options available for treatment and the possible repercussions. I think, furthermore, the subsequent way the international community has communicated and delivered better medical solutions must be applauded and further cognizance given to the cooperative working continuing as we develop the right solutions. Now, I listened with interest to my colleague Sandesh Gulhali, who obviously has massive more experience than I have, and he talked about the right procedures conducted by the right surgeon. And I think that, Deputy Presiding Officer, brings us to the crux of the matter. I would ask, as the committee are considering, for a pause to ensure that the pathway of treatment reflected that desire to have the best treatment by the best surgeon. I once again would like to thank petitioners for their courage and their persistence, and I would like to assure them that they will be heard through the committee. I would also ask the Cabinet Secretary to learn from the mistakes made in dealing with transvaginal mesh. It is entirely reasonable to note the Petitions Committee are considering this, the use of surgical mesh and potentially a moratorium until such times as a full review of all these surgical procedures and that more comprehensive information detailing all treatments are available. We must avoid at all costs another session in committee, as I previously highlighted, when it was too late to prevent such painful complications. And I look forward to further deliberations by the Petitions Committee, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. And I now call Emma Roddick, who will be the last speaker before we move to closing speeches. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I want to start by saying I enjoyed hearing from Jackson Carlaw earlier about the history of campaigning in this place around the use of mesh. And I was very interested to read back on his committee's work over the last few years on this petition. My reliable source of pre-2021 parliamentary gossip has had to pop out for the moment, but Christine Graham does tell me that he's been a stalwart on this very much cross-party issue. And I, like many, am pleased with the progress that was made last year on transvaginal mesh, ensuring that mesh-injured women can access treatment in Scotland or elsewhere with an independent provider if that is what they want to do. And I want to repeat something that I said back then and encourage any of my constituents in the Highlands and Islands who would like a referral to any of these services to make their wishes known to their clinical team, and then they should be able to access the best possible treatment for them as quickly as possible. One strong theme during that debate last year, and reflected in what I just said, was the importance of choice for patients, the choice to see the specialist that they want and not have a particular pathway prescribed by the Scottish Government in exchange for supporting necessary removal of mesh. And that's my concern, and probably my only concern about this petition. There has to be choice for patients. Informed choice, and I'm certain that despite the great steps forward taken in realistic medicine in Scotland, there is work to be done there in making sure that patients feel empowered to understand their treatment, ask questions, and even request alternatives, even through what is undoubtedly a power imbalance between them and their doctor. We've all heard people who've been laughed off for consulting Dr. Google, but patients should be encouraged to find out more about their own needs and their own treatment. Mesh is still considered suitable in some situations, and it wouldn't be reasonable to remove that choice from patients here and now when medical guidance is still that it can be the most effective treatment in some circumstances. And that would be particularly concerning where there is no obvious alternative and certainly no risk-free alternative. I understand that the Minister for Public Health told the committee last year that the Chief Medical Officer had written to health boards to encourage them to consider the availability of non-mesh alternatives and address any skill gaps. And to me, that certainly needs to happen alongside, if not before, efforts to cease the use of mesh altogether. Now, if the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency were to come out and say mesh is not suitable, then this petition's ask would absolutely be the right move. At the moment, the guidance is that it's still suitable in some situations, and I think we've heard that echoed quite clearly from others in the Chamber with medical backgrounds. In the meantime, it is right the NHS is particularly vigilant with procedures where mesh is still used, and I understand that protocols are in place to ensure that. We all have a responsibility here to make sure that lived experience is heard and mesh is not being used inappropriately or carelessly. So I am glad the issue is still being given deserved attention. It's right that the Scottish Government keeps an eye on ongoing work and forthcoming research, as well as any emerging patterns in complaints from patients who have experience of mesh. And I'm sure that many members across the Chamber are going to ensure that eyes are not taken off the ball here. I also want to finish by thanking those who lodged this petition and contributed to the debate surrounding it, because I share their concerns and I completely sympathise with their position. I've read submissions to the committee and it's always devastating to hear that people, and usually women, feel dismissed by doctors when they experience complications or negative symptoms. There's no doubt that mesh has previously been used when it shouldn't have, and women have not been listened to when they should have. And as a young woman with a chronic illness myself, I completely understand that feeling, and I'm all too aware of the possibility that seeking medical help can mean facing condescension or even being ignored and then suffering further harm as a result. So my heartfelt empathy goes out to all those who were brave and passionate enough to use their stories to influence us and to help others. And I hope that regardless of whether and for how long mesh is used going forward, the petitioners know that they have contributed very strongly to the discourse around mesh, the need for specialist mesh removal services, and the wider issue of informed consent. I think we've heard some very considered contributions today, and I hope the impact the petitioners have had on all of us is clear to them. And it would be very helpful to hear from the Scottish Government how monitoring of the use of mesh will happen going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Roddick. Before moving to closing speeches, I would just express some disappointment that we seem to have two members who have not shown the courtesy. Oh, we've got one member who's not shown the courtesy of being here for closing speeches, and presumably that message can be communicated and an apology to the presiding officer given. And we will now move to closing speeches. I call on Paul Sweeney to wind up on behalf of Scottish Labour. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I am grateful for the opportunity to speak in this afternoon's debate on the suspension of surgical mesh, both as a member representing survivors of mesh repair and as a member of the Petitions Committee, which has considered this extremely important matter in various forms over the course of some 10 years, ably convened by the member for Eastwood, and has done so with great diligence and great sympathy and empathy for the people who have been affected by this. And I think it has been the Parliament at its best. It really has been impressive as a new member to this institution to see how accessible and effective it is at addressing serious concerns of marginalised groups in society. And for that, I commend the committee's work. I would like to begin by extending my gratitude, as mentioned by Katie Clarke, to Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall in particular, for their tireless work in keeping this issue on the parliamentary agenda by sharing their own harrowing experiences of mesh repair, as described in quite stark detail by Mr Carlaw earlier, with parliamentarians and the public alike in committee. The constant reliving and sharing of that trauma is not easy, and it's not easy to listen to, and it must be even harder to talk about. And so for that, I'd like to commend their courage in sharing their stories to the committee and serving the public interest so well. And I hope that the Cabinet Secretary has heard those remarks today, and he will consider that very reasonable request for these women to meet with you, to meet the Cabinet Secretary personally, to describe that in detail and how they would like to seek redress, not just merely through the committee, but also through the machinery of government. And I think that is a very reasonable request. Transvaginal mesh is an issue which has been raised in Parliament on a number of occasions, but this petition crucially focuses on the use of surgical mesh and fixation devices elsewhere in the body, and that is a crucial distinction, particularly in relation to hernia repair, which has continued to cause pain and discomfort for survivors. The petitioners have rightly raised the complex problems that mesh can cause, including infection, pain and adhesion. A lack of specialist services for survivors to explore treatment and removal is an issue that we have seen with transvaginal mesh, and unfortunately the lack of treatment options is a key issue for survivors of hernia mesh repair too. There are some mesh specialists scattered throughout Scotland, but it's scarcely enough, and many survivors' referrals to these professionals are rejected, especially if their mesh repair was used for hernia treatment and was not transvaginal. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, medical professionals are trying their best to be of support to mesh survivors, but the simple reality that we have heard through committee in evidence is that there is not a clear pathway for referral and treatment for their patients, who are left feeling alone, isolated and reliant on emotional support from other survivors and their families in the absence of specialist medical treatment. This is not sustainable or acceptable to deprive mesh hernia repair survivors of options to treat or remove mesh, forcing them to live in chronic pain. And that's why I was dismayed by the Conservative spokesperson's citation that they would oppose this agenda today, this petition. I think that is deeply harmful to these women, often women, who have said that they have suffered acute pain. And I think the evidence cited... Happy to give in.
Sandra Gohani.
So it would be the suspension that we would be against, but as you heard in my speech, I would very much be in favour of data gathering and further finding out.
Thank you, and remind members to speak through the chair. Paul Sweeney.
Well, I thank the Conservative spokesperson for that clarification. I think suspension in this instance was about actually addressing real harms experienced here, and I think that is something that should be considered. And the Shadow Minister makes the point about evidence gathering, but the issue is, he described the low rate of defects, for example, the low rate of having to do repairs. But the reality is, how can the evidence be valid or reliable when so many women are denied agency in the healthcare system? That was the very issue that this petition was seeking to address, Deputy Presiding Officer. It was the fact that we're in a kind of logical circular issue. We're short-circuiting the issue. We're not actually addressing the reality that the evidence isn't picking up the lived experience of these individuals. That's what this committee was seeking to serve as a remedy for. And I would hope that the Shadow Minister might consider that whilst there is a necessary need, and hopefully the Minister will also consider this, that we need to gather more evidence, these witnesses' voices have not been heard thus far, and that is simply not acceptable. What are we going to do as a Parliament to address that? What is the Government going to do to address that? And of course, Canada stands as a standout example of what can be done with national specialist centres for surgical repair for mesh and fixation devices. Survivors have expressed that they would like to see that delivered in Scotland. The Shoulders Hospital, specifically devoted to hernia repair. The centre holds the largest single database of hernia patients in the world. Each surgeon performs 600 to 700 hernia surgeries per year. The Shoulders repair technique has the lowest rate of recurrence, as was described by Mr. Carlaw. So it's clearly a model that, whilst in the short term we should be looking to enhance services which already exist in Scotland to better treat and remove mesh, the long-term goal should be to establish a similar national specialist treatment centre where survivors can access the support and treatment that they need from specialist medical professionals. And Deputy Presiding Officer, if I have time in hand, Deputy Presiding Officer.
A brief intervention from Ms. Harper and a brief response. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you for your generosity, Deputy Presiding Officer. Give way.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Paul Sweeney, for giving way. The Shoulders Clinic has caveats like weight loss, stopping smoking, stopping alcohol, and they're very selective in the patients that they take for their non-mesh repair. So it's kind of difficult to compare that with the patient population that we have in Scotland. Would you not agree with that?
Again, members should speak through
the chair. Thank the member for that very reasonable intervention. I think we heard that in evidence. That's certainly an important clarification and useful to have on the record, for sure, that they are important caveats. Nonetheless, it was very explicit and clearly expressed in evidence that having that concentration of medical professionalism and skill was critical to achieving low recurrence rates. That actually doing high volumes in a nationally focused centre was absolutely something important. And as was mentioned by the Shadow Minister, in his remarks about having the need for evidence. Actually, let's look at how the structure of the medical service provision and the treatment pathways are provided. I think that concentration in a national centre is something that was compelling in evidence. So, as Labour Shadow Minister in this area and as previously put to committee, and the Minister previously put to committee, I think it's important that this model is supported and we should look at delivering it. Even though if the Government don't think it's workable, I think it is something that merits further investigation. And if the issue of people living in chronic pain and illness due to mesh repair anywhere in the body is to be tackled, we need ambition, not abdication. These people deserve much better. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I now call on Alexander Stewart to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to close the debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And I strongly welcome the opportunity for Parliament to have this debate here today. As a member of the Petitions Committee myself, I would like to commend our committee convener, Jackson Carlow, and my fellow members of the committee for the way that they have conducted themselves during this whole process. And to have a committee debate here today is an extreme example of what can be achieved. And I really hope that the petitioners see and take forward many of the views that have been expressed today. A common theme throughout the scrutiny of this petition has been that campaigners feel their views are not being heard and they have not been listened to. Following on many of the passionate contributions that we've heard this afternoon, Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope that things come out from this debate will be that campaigners feel that the issue that has been affected is being looked at and is being realised by this Parliament. The issues around the use of transvaginal mesh have been also documented extremely well, and many speakers have talked about the opportunities that have taken place during that time, and the flexibility that's taken place, and the whole idea of mesh and the fixation and devices that have been dealt with, they are much less scrutinised than have been the transvaginal mesh. And I thank the petitioners for their courage in bringing forward this petition and giving us the opportunity to debate it here today. Many of these who have encountered the concerns, and it has been widely recognised that the long-running debate around transvaginal mesh, and as many individuals have talked about today, the work of Jackson Carlow, the work of Alex Neil and Neil Finlay in the previous Parliament in bringing forward and making sure that that was listened to, showed once again how this Parliament can, when working together, achieve great things for the people who they represent. We have seen and we have heard distressing accounts from individuals who have their lives have been turned upside down by mesh complications. Some of those wrote to us and they undertook this in good faith because they were not necessarily aware of many of the risks, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is much to their credit that through their pain and through their procedures, they have decided to talk publicly about that process. And it's also widely taken that many individuals suffered extremely and continue to suffer. And we have a role to play to ensure that that is recognised here within this Parliament. And we are their voice and we will give them the chance. And as I say, today has shown how that can be achieved. And I'd like to talk about what people have said today, because what has been said by many people about this whole process is vitally important. You know, we've heard about the Scottish Health Technology Group continue to support the use of mesh and hernia. We've also heard about many of the mesh-related complications that have taken place. And as I say, and many speakers have spoken about their constituents and about individuals who they have had personal contact with about how that takes place. It is our an opportunity for us to ensure that there is greater clarity when it comes to certain types of devices and the uses of their procedures. With that being said, Deputy Premier, our experience of dealing with this issue, especially when it came to transvaginal mesh and the technology that was going with that, many people experienced problems, and that has been talked about. It's also important to consider alternative treatments and pathways to mesh. Now, that's been discussed today, and the evidence that we took as a committee from Canada when it came to Dr. Fernando Special Nito at the Shoulders Hospital in Canada. He talked about and gave evidence to us and suggested, and it's been useful to hear comments from others today about what's been happening at that hospital. Scotland, of course, has a different healthcare system than Canada and has some different population dynamics when it comes to managing all of that. But nevertheless, the government has taken seriously the consideration and learning lessons from what's happening in Canada. Presiding Officer, as expected today, has debate has seen a number of important and passionate contributions, and I'd like to dwell on them for a moment or two. Our convener, Jackson Carlow, as I've said, you know, talked about the life-changing effects and also talked about data and the way that the Scottish Health Technology Group suggested that there were 10,500 hernia repairs that took place in Scotland, and 62% of these procedures were dealt with mesh, and that 32 procedures removed, but there was not enough data about to find out the real aspects of that. The Cabinet Secretary himself, in his opening statement, talked about the distress to patients and acknowledged that distress, and that's vitally important, the adverse effects that these individuals have suffered, and also talked about data collection and the issues regarding that, and then moved on to local clinical groups rather than the national centre that has been suggested by the petitioners. My colleague, Dr. Sandish Gulhani, who has expert knowledge and experience in many of this, talked about the need to have petitions like this so that there can be the opportunity to debate and discuss. He spoke about the issues that are happening on Canada and the risks that come in place with patient size, with complications, with infection, chronic pain and numbness. All of that's vitally important to ensure that the best is given to them all. Jackie Bailey gave a very strong and passionate speech, as she always does, on health topics, and I enjoyed it greatly. The Scottish Government must learn lessons, she talked about, and it's important that the Scottish Government learn lessons. Lived experience was talked about from Jackie, and pathways were needed. These are vitally important, and 10 years have taken, and nothing has happened, Jackie, and all of the comments that you've made, I do hope that the Cabinet Secretary takes on board. Alex Cole-Hamilton also spoke about the risks and the side effects and the tragic stories that we've all had to deal with. And that in itself, Deputy Presiding Officer, is the crux of the story, because we have all heard and seen and got the lived experiences from constituents. Megan Gallagher once again spoke about data and the evidence-based approach, but also talked about waiting times that are everyone's experiencing at present and how that knock-on effect could have a real impact on their way forward. Emma Harper, a nurse herself, spoke about the crucial and the critical tool of that mesh is, and that people should be treated with kindness and compassion and respect. We would hope that would be the case in all individuals, but we have seen and we have heard that many people found that not to be the case. Brian Whittle spoke about the effects that he had and what he saw when he saw the transitional mesh situation. So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, today we have had the real opportunity to see firsthand, and I hope that the cloud of all our warning signals that have taken place is about ensuring that we do not see and we do not have the same mistakes made again that have been made in the past. Everyone who has suffered due to mesh in the past, or anyone who might in the future, risks and the skill that takes forward, we owe it to them to ensure that we do all we can to ensure that they are listened to, they are understood, and that they are respected for the report. And as I say, I commend the petitioners for what they've done so far. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Around 8 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank all of the members from across the Chamber for their contributions? It's been a very good debate. There has been very common themes that have been raised right throughout from members again across the Chamber, but also very diverging opinions on what the next steps should be. That it hasn't diminished at all from the debate. Sometimes we can only assume that the best debates are consensual. That's not always the case. But there is consensus on a number of points, and maybe I should start at that place first. So there is absolute consensus that those petitioners that are raising these issues, that we all have gratitude to them for sharing their stories and sharing the stories of their loved ones, but also that their pain that they are describing, be it on their own behalf or on behalf of a loved one, is very real. There's nobody here who is doubting that. And as I said already, I would be greatly upset and quite frankly angry and annoyed if stories are brought to my attention where simply issues around pain and chronic pain are being dismissed by clinicians. I don't think that would be the experience of the majority of people, but I accept in some testimonies we've heard that has been the experience of some. And as I say, I'm very open to members of the public, or indeed members of this chamber, writing to me directly in relation to some of those concerns. Where else do we have consensus? I think we have consensus in the fact that government mainly should be learning from some of the journey that we went on in relation to the women who were affected by transvaginal mesh issues. I don't take away from what was said from critics when they argue that perhaps it shouldn't have taken, well, definitely shouldn't have taken 10 years to get to the place where we eventually ended up. So I think that's fair, and I think it's imperative that government does learn from that, and I'm absolutely committed to doing that. On the points of some difference, really the difference centres on what happens next. There are some members who very passionately are arguing for a complete suspension of the use of mesh and hernia mesh. There are others who are saying that that would not be the right approach. I think I'd be right in saying probably the majority of contributions saying that that probably is not the right approach at this stage, but one to be continually kept under review. All that being said, for those that have called for a suspension of mesh, I hope they will be, at least in part, because they will be disappointed, but in part reassured by the fact that we are aiming to improve data collection, which is another common theme. Now, what does that look like? There has been some work that has been done already and undertaken by the British Hernia Society, which I think a number of members will be very, very aware of. But also in terms of our own working on data collection, what we're aiming to do is that the the NHS Scotland Scan for Safety programme will effectively improve patient safety. It's going to provide electronic traceability linking patients to implantable devices in acute care, so we can get that real-time data electronically in relation to any issues that might be cropping up. As I say, that's in addition to the work that's been done by the British Hernia Society. They've made progress in establishing their own registry, which they'll begin piloting shortly, and we'll be watching that closely and working with the British Hernia Society very much where appropriate. I wanted to address some of the other issues that were raised by a number of members across the chamber. I thought Sandesh Gohani's contribution, and actually more so, if it doesn't mind me saying, his exchange with Jackson Carlow was very interesting to watch, because Dr. Gohani, I think, made it very, very clear in his response to Jackson Carlow that, first of all, of course, the clinical advice that is provided is one that people should, of course, listen to. But equally, we all agree that that should be a discussion between patient and clinician. But equally, he also said that he had no issue with a mesh implant, either in himself or indeed within another family member. So we can see from a clinical perspective that there continues to be a high level of confidence, because what Dr. Gohani expressed has been expressed by many clinicians right across the country, up and down the country. We saw that from the Scottish Health and Technologies Group too. So there is a high degree of clinical confidence in the continued use of mesh. Now, where alternatives can be explored, they should be explored if that is what the patient wishes, and it should be made very clear, as with any surgery, of course, the potential complications or risks that are inherent with the use of mesh. But informed consent, and this was an issue that was raised by many members, and Siobhan Brown asked specific questions around informed consent. Let me give her and other members an absolute guarantee that informed consent is not just an issue that I take very seriously, it's an issue I've discussed with our Chief Medical Officer, and he takes it very seriously too. And I'm very encouraged to hear from patient groups that informed consent processes have improved quite significantly, and the importance of shared decision making and informed consent is the very centrepiece of realistic medicine. Again, something government often talks about, but something that is very close to the heart of the Chief Medical Officer. We want people to be fully involved in the decisions about their care. That's why we're encouraging people to ask their healthcare professionals questions to help them to make those informed choices, and equally for clinicians to ask questions when they're in discussions with their patients. What are the benefits? What are the benefits? What are the risks? What are the alternatives? And what if I do nothing? These are the questions that we expect clinicians and indeed patients to be asking each other. I'll give way to
Jackson Carlow.
Briefly, would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that 10 years ago it would have been impossible, 5 years ago it would have been unlikely, but this afternoon we have had a substantive, informed debate with contributions from all across the chamber on the subject of mesh? And is that not actually the perfect tribute to all those campaigners who, over the last 10 years, have worked so hard to ensure that this Parliament understands the issues underpinning mesh as well as they now do?
Cabinet Secretary.
Not for the first time in this debate, I agree wholeheartedly with Jackson Carlow. I'm beginning to doubt myself in the amount of times I've agreed with Jackson Carlow on this afternoon, I have to say. But he has, and I say that only in jest, because he knows that he has my admiration as well as the admiration of the government in relation to the excellent work that he has done on the issue of mesh, both transvaginal mesh and indeed the wider issues on mesh. And I've been in front of his committee that he convenes, and he takes, I know how seriously he and other committee members take these issues. And I also hope that the testimonies and the stories and the bravery that has been shown by the women that have been affected by transvaginal mesh does give confidence for others to come up and speak about their own complications and their own health in relation to their own health, whether that's mesh or otherwise. And actually, that should be seen as a good thing. Although there may be disagreements between us in relation to the way forward, people speaking about their health openly, raising issues about complications or harmful impacts of any procedure, it's important the government knows about that. It's important the health service knows that. Of course, I give way to
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, but would you agree, though, that in encouraging people to speak up, it's really important that they are listened to? And that what happened previously with the transvaginal mesh, that their comments are keen to hear what they have to say.
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree wholeheartedly with that, and that was a common theme from the women who were affected by trans vaginal mesh. I've continued to try to make progress in terms of some of the other issues that were raised. I think a couple of members have asked if I will meet with the petitioners. I don't know if I've had a request to meet, if I'll double-check that, but of course I will give that absolute full and due consideration. I'm not necessarily convinced that it will change my opinion given the Scottish Health and Technologies Group reviews and reports, but there's nothing to be lost from meeting with petitioners, with members of the public about their experience and their families' experience, so I will give that obviously consideration when a letter or correspondence comes to me to that effect. I think it's an important point. Jackie Bailey and a couple of other members mentioned Canada and other international examples we should look to. I think there's a very fair comment that we should look to other jurisdictions and other countries across the world. I'm not sure, maybe I have the wrong information, but I'm not sure that Canada has suspended or halted mesh in its entirety. I think they have for transvaginal mesh, but whether they've done that for all mesh procedures, I'm not entirely sure, but I will double check that, and if that is the case, of course, then we should be linking in with our health colleagues in Canada.
Brief intervention and brief response. Paul Sweeney.
Thank the Minister for giving me that point. We addressed the issue of the structure, the specialist surgical centre. That was a key aspect of the evidence from the Canadians. Would you consider that replication in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have considered it, and the points that were made by Marie Todd in front of committee when she was asked about that very point remain. We were talking about two very different health systems. I referenced them in my opening comments as well. If we were to have, for example, a specialist centre for the number of hernia operations are done, then that may involve people having to travel to one particular centre where actually they could be seen closer to home. But let's not dismiss the issues that are raised about pathways and specialist centres. I know I'm running vastly over time already, so let me just reflect. And I recall one of the debates when we were taking forward the Transvaginal Mesh Removal Cost Reimbursement Act, and in that I commented that our work on mesh had really shown this Parliament at its very best. And I really just end on the point that Jackson Carlow made in his intervention. I hope we can continue to work in this spirit when considering what more can be done to the patients, although they may be disappointed in the fact that the government is not suspending the use of mesh and hernia operations. I am listening, we are listening, and we're committed to ensuring that people get the care that they need.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call on David Torrens to wind up the debate on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. Around 9 minutes, please, Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to be closing the extremely important debate on behalf of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee. I would like to thank my fellow committee members and, of course, the committee clerks whose support, hard work and guidance to elected members is vital and very much appreciated by the committee. Thank you also to my colleagues who have contributed to today's debate. As the convener set out earlier, the Cabinet Secretary, Alex Gohamilton, and many of my colleagues have mentioned throughout, we can be left in little doubt about the devastating impact surgical mesh had on some patients across Scotland and the fight to be believed about their condition. In our consideration of this position, the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee has gathered a wide range of evidence to assist our understanding of the use of surgical mesh and its impact. I'd also like to put on record my thanks to petitioners Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall and all those who have shared their experiences of this issue with committee over the course of the past 20 months. This is not the first time we have debated the effects of mesh treatment. As a Parliament, we have been speaking about surgical mesh in one way or another for almost 10 years now. Jackson and I were both members of the Petitions Committee when the issue of transvaginal mesh was introduced, and I am honoured to be standing here today with Jackson as convener and I as vice-convener of the committee as we debate this petition. While we made welcome progress for those suffering from complications from the use of transvaginal mesh, the issues of Rosanna and Lauren have raised in the petition remain to be resolved. It is for that reason I want to focus my remarks this afternoon on the finding solution to concerns that have been raised. Since the petition was submitted to Parliament for our consideration, the Scottish Health Technologies Group has published two reports on the use of mesh in hernia repair. The first of these reports provided an assessment of the use of surgical mesh for repair in hernia in male patients, and Dr. Gahani mentioned this earlier on in the findings that the use of a mesh meant that men were less likely to have their hernia return. The report also found that use of mesh meant men were less likely to suffer urinary retention, injury to nerves, blood vessels or internal organs, but did report that patients were more likely to develop a build-up of fluid or swelling soon after surgery. The SHTG have recommended all elective In good health, hernia repairs should be preceded by detailed discussion with patients to help manage their post-surgery expectation. As we've heard from patients, it is vital that these discussions do take place ahead of any surgery to ensure that they can reach a fully informed decision about their health. We've heard how the recommendations were further developed in the second SHD report, which explored the use of surgical mesh in repairs of the abdominal and groin hernias in adults, not just male patients. While both reports have concluded that evidence appears to support the continued use of surgical mesh in hernia repair, it is worth highlighting the recommendations that patients' preference for non-mesh repair and access to alternative hernia management options should be available. The report also mentions that patients should be provided with detailed information on hernia repair in a variety of accessible formats. Anyone who has been in a hospital appointment to discuss treatment options will know how challenging it is to absorb all the relevant information and feel confident that they are making a fully informed decision. So making this information available for in other formats, written and verbal, would certainly be a positive development. The committee heard the Chief Medical Officer wrote to all health boards in December 2021, highlighting the SHD report, asking them to consider the availability of non-mesh surgery. We also heard from one of the Scottish Government's senior medical advisers, Terry O'Kelly, who stated during our evidence session in June 2022 that it is critical that, when appropriate, patients have access to non-mesh surgery, which might be provided by their health board or by another health board elsewhere in Scotland. As raised by Paul Sweeney this afternoon, the committee also heard from patients this is critical in ensuring there are patient pathways for those who, having been made aware of risk, do want to pursue an option of non-mesh treatment.
I think we'll take a quick...
Yes.
Emma Harper.
I thank David, as Deputy Convener, David Torrance, for taking an intervention. We've talked about mesh this afternoon, but we haven't really talked about the titanium fixation devices, which is also part of Rosanna Clarkin and Lord McDougall's petition. Would he agree that further discussion might be necessary, further evidence might need to be taken, and that also we have biodegradable fixation devices now, and they're being used more often?
David Torrance.
I thank the member for her intervention. The committee is still taking evidence around what is raised in the petition, so I think there is scope there for us to look at what has been suggested by Emma Harper. As a key aspect of ensuring patients have access to... As a key aspect of ensuring that patients have access to those alternatives will be identifying any skills or training gaps. And as the convener has mentioned already this afternoon, we look forward to hearings and findings of the Scottish Association of Medical Directors' report on the availability of non-mesh surgery in health boards across Scotland. It may feel like a long time coming, but we welcome steps to support patients in making informed decisions before any surgery takes place. Getting things right at the beginning of a patient's journey is important. We have heard a lot throughout the committee's deliberations and indeed this afternoon about the complications that arise when mesh doesn't work as patients and clinicians have hoped. There is a small minority of surgeons who prefer to use natural tissue repair and only use mesh as a last resort. As a committee, we're interested to hear about more of the approach, as the convener touched on earlier at the beginning of the debate, and Alexander Stewart and several other members have mentioned, we took evidence from the Shoulders Hernia Hospital in Canada. Shoulders is the only licensed hospital in the world dedicated to hernia repairs and has been a steadfast supporter of natural tissue hernia repair for over 76 years, performing over 400,000 abdominal wall hernia repairs. To date, we use mesh in less than 2%, so mesh is still used in Canada in all other cases, and their surgical outcomes remain the gold standard in abdominal wall hernia repair. The committee held a virtual evidence session with Dr. Fenner Spencer Netto, the Chief Surgeon at Shoulders Hospital, to discuss the work of the hospital during this session and were given his views towards the use of mesh. When asked Dr. Netto, would a ban in the use of mesh in hernia repairs be a good thing? His response was, in some situations, there is no possibility ever than to close the opening with mesh. Sometimes the hernias improve. The surgeon's knowledge of how to treat hernias also improves. The stats from today are probably very different from the stats on patients who were operated on 5 to 10 years ago. In relation to hernia repairs, it is not possible for there to be a ban, because in some situations, using mesh is the only way to do a good repair. Given the success of the Shoulders Hospital with natural tissue repair, which have resulted in low reoccurrence of hernias, it is extremely helpful to speak with the surgeon as experienced of Dr. Netto. Nothing less, however, there is undoubtedly much that can be learned with regards to skill, training and techniques that are used in the Shoulders Hospital, it is important that these successes and achievements must be taken into context of our own healthcare system and culture. Pre-operative preparation and post-operative care for hernia repair surgery in Scotland and patients treated at the Shoulders differs greatly in terms of application and strict criteria selection. The hospital applies selection criteria such as weight loss before admitting patients to the Shoulders Hospital. We also do not take patients who might have more complex medical needs, such as those who might need a backup from cardiology or intensive care units. Dr. Nettle told us, if a patient in question is to choose and wants to undergo weight loss, this is okay. Sometimes there are patients who need to lose, say, £50. Indeed, there have been patients who have to lose £100 or more before they have had their operation. Sometimes we also change the estimated ideal weight a little bit. One of the suitable criteria for a patient's medical condition is if they have chronic conditions, it needs to be stable before they can have an operation. With obesity, though, it is questionable whether we can do tissue repair, because operation is a lot more difficult, the incisions have to be bigger, wound can be infected, there can be more hematomas, and frequently one complication will lead to another. That is why we always try to patients to get to the correct weight. Unless there are some very specific things that happen, most of them reach a correct weight, or at least get very close to it, and they have an operation. I'm 100% sure that that makes a difference to the final result of individual patients. This raises an important question regarding restriction of access to treatment because of personal criteria and whether such criteria could be brought into play here and would be acceptable to the members of the public. For some patients, the use of surgical mesh may be the most appropriate option available to them. It is important to note that the petitioner have not called for a permanent ban on the use of mesh, but rather a suspension of its use until we can understand the complications better and ensure robust guidelines for it to be established. The evidence of our committee has gathered indicates that there is still work to be done to track the outcomes of the use of surgical mesh. And as the Minister has mentioned in the evidence, there are challenges in tracing what products have been used and which of these are causing harm. While recognising the regulation of the medical devices as a reserved matter, the committee has also noted cross-party support in this Parliament for the Scottish Government's efforts to make progress on the issue around regulation of these devices. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, our committee has a powerful testimony from individuals living in constant pain following the use of mesh. We have heard from experts on the alternatives that could be used, and we have heard about the need to improve patients' pathways and embed a culture of informed consent. What has been clear, as we have heard all this evidence, is that we cannot wait another 10 years for the solutions to be developed and implemented.
Thank you.